one, I don't even know if that was friendly banter. He's like, oh, it doesn't matter if I feed in lane because Keese is going to throw the game anyway.
And I actually saw Altec backstage before the games, and I was like, hey, so what's up with, are you friends with Keith? And he's like, really want to go hard. And Moon was there, and he's like, oh, it's still true, though. But Altec was like, no, we're good friends. It's okay. I was like, all right, that's fair. But I enjoyed the discussion.
I like it.
Either way, we are into picks and bans and top laners being removed. Also, the Rengar of Acadian gone as well. We'll see what else comes in. Of course, we are still on 7.5 for this one. Same patch as last week.
Mm-hmm. Ball's Rumble going to be taken away. Something that it's really been one of the only kind of carry style top laners that he has been playing much this season. Besides that, he pretty much has been on tanks. And, you know, they may want to target Ball's heavily here in the draft, but we're going to have to see where the game plan goes.
See what happens. Graves off the table as well. So two top laners, two junglers right now. And might even be that the Nautilus ban prevents the Mordekaiser bot lane. FlyQuest shooting themselves in the foot. Shen also gone here, really moving tanks from the Looper champion pool, which is interesting because I don't feel like Ball's been playing very well on carry top. I think his best style champion is actually playing the Shen and Nautilus.
Well, and I mean, with something like this, it can simply be, if you're not willing to first pick the Shen, and they've already banned out Rumble, which is kind of one of the natural counters to Shen, you don't really want to give that over to Looper because it's extremely powerful as far as moving around the map. And if you cannot dominate Shen in lane, he gets so much out of the split push pressure, the global pressure that he brings to his team.
I totally agree. It's definitely strong, but they're actually going to go for the Camille anyway. So unless it's a Phoenix 1 special and goes into the support role, Balls is going to play a champion that is not supposed to be lane dominant, to be fair, but I guess more of a diver and utility into the late game, but it's still one that feels like a carry top as far as you know, contrasting it with the Shen, the Nautilus, the Maokais of the world.
And I think one of the big things about Camille is while she may not have the most dominant of lanes, if she gets going, it's extremely snowball-y because you can almost not ever escape this champion. But you're going to give up a lot to first pick Camille with Lulu open. Mm-hmm. Lulu has been extremely popular in the meta, I think unlocking a lot of opportunities for more carry-oriented style AD carries.
Yep.
We'll see if Keith's going to try to bring something like that out because he's pretty much only been on Ashe.
Sure, but we've seen some Kog'Maw played around the world. We've seen some Twitch actually just earlier today. We saw Twitch come out to an early lead, but couldn't quite close the game out. We'll see if that comes through. Early Gragas pickup here for FlyQuest jungle with exactly two of them banned away. The third one up on the docket was his Gragas, so a bit of stuff there. And the Zyra as the counter pick into Lulu and a matched jungler here as Kha'Zix comes in.
And Kha'Zix has certainly fallen off in priority, but still very strong. It's not the kind of first pick, first ban type thing that we were seeing a lot earlier in the season. Definitely one of the Acadian's best champions. With Graves off the table, I think it makes a lot of sense. And Renekton's going to match up very well against that Camille. I think it's someone who can take over against the Camille early if he does get help there. So I think you can already expect to see quite a bit of attention placed on the top lane with two pretty explosive top laners and powerful early junglers.
Totally agree. That could be an easy focal point. But we'll see, of course, based on what the matchups are on the rest of the lanes. Of course, Zyra can be plenty aggressive. And if we do see a Kog'Maw or Twitch, it's an easy enough champion to fight. But it's really up to what kind of style they want to play. Caitlyn on the table as well as someone who might benefit from that kind of stuff. Talon and Ahri dropped off so far. Mid-Assassins being removed away. Echo Fox does need magic damage at some point on their kit with a physical damage jungler, physical damage top. Cinder rounds out the Echo Fox bans.
I mean, there's still a lot of options here for the mid lane. Orianna still up, sits out as someone who's a pretty obvious blind pick mid laner to me. I think that champion does not really have a lot of natural counters or tough matchups. And obviously on the other side of things, Cassiopeia, there's still many options here for the teams.
Yeah, Vladimir's one that I've seen as a pretty common blind pick as well. So much so that I continually saw it last week as a red side second phase ban. They're consistently banning Vladimir away from the blue team that has to blind pick a mid laner, usually speaking. I say have to, so usually speaking, they blind pick a mid laner in the second phase, and we'll see what happens. Cassiopeia, the final ban.
Yeah, so Echo Fox certainly does have some options remaining here. As you said, I do think that they are going to need some AP, especially with Gragas and Camille, who can itemize somewhat towards that tanky nature. Against some teams, it's fine to go full AD if you're going up against someone who's not really going to be building armor, if it's kind of pure DPS type teams. But when you do have the tanks, you really do have to kind of give yourself some flexibility there.
And we saw there Keith hovering the champions he wanted to play, we presume, the Vayne, the Lucian, the more mechanical, flashy ones, and instead it's going to be his 75th straight game of Ashe. Quote me, that's the exact number. It's been 3 years straight. Never been banned away.
It's got to feel bad for Keith, honestly. It just feels like he's been completely relegated to this champion. His team does not seem to have a lot of faith in him, and he is getting put on Ashe time and time again, simply because it feels like the most effective AD carry when you don't get any help. You always have the arrows, you do have some sort of baseline level of effectiveness. But that said, I just, it's not working for the team, and I would have liked to see them try something different when they have the Lulu.
Yeah, I think you're right, honestly. I know Ashe can put out good damage. She is a natural Hurricane user, has some good damage scaling. Like, I have seen Ashe players take over games, but you're right, it's not what they're looking at. But I'm like, ooh, yeah, Keith, get on that Ashe and start carrying
the fights. The last 15 times in a row it didn't work. It's going to work this time, though.
Well, true, definition of insanity and all that. 1-7 match record recently. Victor going to come out as the final ban here for Froggen. It's actually interesting. The Twisted Fate used to be banned against him every single game. That's been gone away for a while. Instead, the lineups continue and have been rounded out. Caitlyn on the one side for FlyQuest, and of course, there's Ashe in for Keith. And the Orianna-Victor matchup, I feel like I've seen that a million times as well.
Yeah, definitely have. Froggen has taken over some games on the Victor. I think he certainly can be that carry-style player. I like FlyQuest's composition quite a bit here. I think that they have more powerful bot lane. They have really strong early jungler. They have great AoE damage and team fighting with the Zyra, the Gragas, and the Orianna. I just think across the board, they have a very solid composition. Obviously, yeah. Echo Fox is not really a slouching team here either as far as their composition, but I think it's going to be tough for them when their bot lane is already struggling so heavily, and I favor FlyQuest's 2v2 pretty heavily.
Sure, and speaking of 2v2s, I actually like their top lane 2v2 as well. Balls is going to really want Ninja Tabby, physical damage top and jungle. They're even both auto-attack focused, which makes it even better. And yeah, I feel like Balls will have a decent time against the matchup he's in. By contrast, Moon deals magic damage, so Looper, if he does get Ninja Tabby himself, still takes full damage from Gragas, and sometimes that matters. That 20% damage difference from the second member of the team can turn a lot.
It really can, and I think just in general, when you have already a CC top laner and then CC coming out of your jungler as well, it's very risky to bully a lane. Like, when you're playing Renekton, you want to shove them up, you want to pressure them, but if you get too far up, you get stunned up by Camille, easy follow-up for Gragas, or vice versa, and you're probably going to go down.
Yeah, and as soon as it's level 6, you are not slice and dicing out of that pit. You have no knockback that's going to get you, so fun game to watch out for. Of course, FlyQuest still fighting out around the 6th-place spot to get themselves into playoffs. Echo Fox need to grab a couple of wins to make sure they do not fall into the promotion tournament as game 1 is underway, and it's going to be a fun one. Balls gets the first pick. Camille, Moon on the Gragas, and we'll see if FlyQuest can turn around a late season slide. 1-7 in their last 8 matches. They can still make playoffs. They have the easiest schedule left of any team in week 9. They are supposed to 2-0, but we'll see if they can do it.
They are, and I mean, I think the schedule is pretty easy, but when you look at their recent record, you know, maybe this is just the level of team that they are, right?
Sure.
You know, you're looking, okay, yeah, they're a team that's up in the playoffs. They should very easily beat these other teams, but they have the same kind of record within the last 8 games. They've both really been struggling, and, you know, a lot of people have been talking about the struggles of FlyQuest as far as scrims. You know, Dardock kind of calling out FlyQuest recently, saying that they don't really put forth the effort in scrims, don't take them seriously, and Hi a couple of weeks ago even saying that, hey, they have the most consistent record.
0%
win rate.
I know, rough stuff here. At least their match score is better than that, but still a lot of room to go for a team that was challenging for first place at the beginning of the split. It's such a good start. It was Cloud9 White and Cloud9 Blue, and now it's actually kind of both those squads that have been having a bit more of a slide, but at this point, it's going to come down to the final 2 matches and the potential postseason.
And you never know what a team like this could pull off if you can sneak into the playoffs, because I think that one of their strengths is their match planning. They're willing to do some risky strategies, and I think that if you go into a best of 5 with some kind of crazy strategies under your belt, you can certainly upset some teams, take some games away.
Yep. We'll see if that happens. We are, of course, into this one as the early jungle leash is going to be a bit different. It's going to be a red buff start, actually, for Acadian that is somewhat less typical than the normal Raptor start that we just saw Moon get. And this is actually a little bit new as well. I haven't actually really seen Krugs before red much, but this is what Moon's going to go for with this start.
And I think both these guys are just looking for some different starts. I mean, Acadian looking for a level 2 cheesy gank here on Fly. We'll see if they can get it.
Deep Sin forcing the flash at a high. All right, that buys him some, you know, it loses him some time, but now it's a summoner spell advantage. Of course, high, no escapes, and he's run Ignite in the mid lane matchup, makes him an easy repeat gank target.
And one of the big things to note there is this was not a long camp for Acadian. Yes, it does take some of his time, but he did not invest a massive amount of time there. And Moon going for a super early base, so he may be trying to throw off his opponents as far as gank timing. I'm not sure if he's going to go back for the
boots,
red buff, or what he's trying to do. But that early base seems a little bit strange, because he's actually going to end up behind on camps being farmed here.
Yeah, it is strange. We'll have to see what he's actually going to do with this one. Maybe he wants to stay around on the map for a long time now, and he's going to have like this level 4 or level 5 gank timing. Obviously, this is an undisturbed jungle start, so Moon had to have practiced this. He has to believe this is a good start for him. And look, I'm always excited to see new build orders, which is kind of how I consider early jungle pathing. And I trust Moon on it. I just want to see what it comes out.
I'm expecting some sort of bot lane gank. Like, that's what would make the most sense to me. If you can get something like that set up, maybe a late timing, but he's already cheating towards topside, so it's not going to be what he's looking for.
Level 3 here, and of course, Acadian halfway all the way. Well, actually, to be fair, Acadian has just recalled himself now, right? So they've both recalled the base once. Moon's actually already on the map, but granted, Acadian got to gank once, so saying that Acadian's behind in jungles is almost unfair to say, and we'll see what it continues on to right now, but you're right. I want to see if it pays off into something.
Yeah, I'm trying to think what exactly it is that Moon's accomplishing with this, because for now it feels like, well, if he was just going to do a full clear, he could have actually stayed on the map, done a full clear, based with a better item timing. But we'll give him the benefit of the doubt, see what he can pull off here. And they certainly do still have the opportunity to look top lane, where they have some great gank assist, and he now has that blue buff.
Well, he does get level 4 first. He's going to walk in with Caden's control ward and kill that pretty easily, and I don't think with a level deficit, I don't feel like the Kha'Zix is going to fight that. So for now, he's okay. Quick stun comes in from Looper, of course. They had seen where the Gragas was, and he knew he was safe to go for the trade. Balls doesn't get the auto attack until after the combo lands, so the shield does nothing. Props to Looper for stunning early to prevent that. Now all in towards Lemonation. Ignite is on plenty of damage output here. Is there going to be a flash follow? Looks like not. Gate a bit injured, and of course, with someone to heal up for all tech, there's no chance to kill.
And Lemon doesn't have any more pots remaining, so chunking him out like that may end up being worthwhile, but if he doesn't go down, then that you're going to be at a summoner disadvantage here for Echo Fox. And right now, Cadian looking for another gank here up on top side. If Balls goes aggressive, he could be in a lot of trouble.
But Balls should know that Cadian was seen pretty recently top side in front of Raptors, so I feel like he's supposed to play this one defensively for a little while until that bot lane, or the bot jungle actually respawns, and right now it hasn't so much, so shouldn't be much for Balls. Nice, actually, Looper landed that Q. Barely in range for a little bit of damage. And yeah, the Acadian gank's not going to do anything.
Yeah, either way, I think it's a smart move for Acadian, because Looper wanted to shove in the wave. This way, you're protecting your top laner from any sort of gank that Moon could pull off, potentially set up a counter gank there. So a little bit of a time investment. Obviously, the downside of that is Moon is getting ahead as far as camp's taken. He's a little bit up on the experience.
He's a full level. He's more than a full level ahead right now. Of course, Acadian was camping, waiting for the bot jungle to respawn, and he'll get Gromp and he'll get bottom scuttle, but I don't think that reaches level 5 for him, so this is still a long road ahead. And well, for what it's worth, Moon's pathing has seemed to work out for him okay, but a lot of this Acadian's been not farming for a fair portion of this game. Still level 4.5 to Moon, still 5.5, and back for his next clear.
And it does kind of come down to, hey, can you actually get some sort of an advantage off the fact that Hai is down a flash, right? And with Hai's flash pretty close to coming back up, it hasn't looked like it. So, you know, if you force that summoner, it's great, but it doesn't actually accomplish anything unless you can follow up and execute on that kill, get yourself an advantage.
We'll see if any advantage comes through, but right now it hasn't, and Hai's flash, as you had mentioned, coming up very soon. Bot lane has been trading pretty close to equal.
I think they're going to look to go here with Froggen at 6, and the flash is still down. They will look for this kill. Lulu's even coming up, so they're going to try 3-man high.
See if they can make it happen. High right now cheating to the top side, and he has Moon near him as well, and they're looking for the Raptor respawn, I guess. And it's just, all right, well, you went to gank, I went to farm. Pretty much the inverse Acadian right now, and Moon gets to take the Raptors away. He'll walk back to lane.
A long time for this, and it's not going to pay off. It doesn't seem
top
like
side. Well, nice attempt by Echo Fox. I like the idea, though. You could tell that if you burn the flashlight early, it will still be down when level 6 comes in, right? That was the timing window they're hoping for, but of course it didn't happen, and now we're going to see a red buff steal.
And I think that FlyQuest actually played very intelligently around this. You could see Hai cheating to the top side, where his jungler was in this kind of moment of weakness right before his summoner came back up. Then they rotate Balls down just in case there is a 3-man gank. They would have 3 members there to answer it. Now that his members are gone, he's kind of cheating away. He's moving outside of lane. So I think Hai is playing very well around the summoner disadvantage, and it's right back up now.
Looper's coming in, level advantage, a lot of damage out from Moon. Whoa, he misplayed it! He didn't explosive cast him far enough. Hai thought he was going to come in. The first blood not going to come through to Looper, though. Dangerously close now. Froggen on the chase, but he is in a 1v3. Ulti's in, looks for Balls. Not going to be the easiest to kill up Camille as they flash forward into this one. The ulti's in, they can't get the damage, and Balls donates first blood over to Froggen, and I think he could have run away with it. And instead, one kill comes to Echo Fox inside their own jungle.
Oh, that was very poorly executed there from FlyQuest. It should have been an easy first blood, but whether Hai was expecting the ultimate to knock him back into the shockwave, or he thought his ball was already on Moon. There was definitely some mistakes there, and they end up giving over a kill. Plus, all the flashes of FlyQuest topside are now down. Let's watch this one more time. There is the ultimate. Yeah, that's exactly what it was. He did not knock him. He knocked him right into the wall instead of over to the side a little bit. So Hai was trying to time that ultimate to be right out of the Gragas cask and then sticking around here a little bit too long as...
Ball just has YOLO. And
yeah, I mean, Ball's wanted to pick up the kill, but you have to give the respect that Looper is going to be there, that Acadian is still going to be hanging around.
Yeah, so definitely gives up the life for that one. He tried, but it's not going to work. Ninja Tappy done for the Camille should make it easier in the lane matchup, but Balls is down 7 CS, and he's down that assist that Looper got for this one. The game right now is only 200 gold apart, so you can't really call up anyone just yet. Bot lane has been pretty equal. We are going to see the Blade of the Rune King Ash build. Sneaky had said he hasn't really seen it very much, but got to be interesting to watch for.
And I'll be interested to see if he actually does go for the Black Cleaver second, as that has been the Korean build.
Right.
Is the Blade of the Rune King into that Black Cleaver. Not something we've really been seeing in North America, but something that seems to have developed a lot of popularity in the LCK for both Ash and Lucian.
Yep, absolutely. It's definitely been a good early item, and it scales with the game already. Lifesteal percent health damage always nice. Bot lane fight coming in. Gate gonna be knocked up. Here's the Q across. He chooses not to flash and doesn't need to. Despite level 6 coming in first for FlyQuest, Gate survives the encounter. Well played by him.
Lemon actually didn't use his Ignite there, and had he just thrown down the Ignite,
I think he actually
gets the kill or forces the flash, you know, depending on how Gate plays it. But definitely should have thrown down the Ignite. If you're willing to commit the full ultimate combo onto the support, you drop your Ignite for sure.
I definitely agree with you on that one. Maybe misplay of elimination giving that one away, but that's the way it is. Speaking of advantages, though, you got a pretty solid one. Froggen, 100 CS at 9 minutes 45, and he's more than 20 ahead of Hai right now. So props to Froggen. Some of that probably Hai having to play defensively because of his flash being down. I assume that's some part of it, but you can see the gold difference is 800 thanks to the farm and the kill lead. So who's surprised? Acadian looked for early ganks in the mid lane. Didn't get first blood this time. That's a new one, but Froggen has a massive gold lead and it looks like it's going to be on him to carry.
And that's kind of the trade-off, right? So Acadian is behind on gold because of his more aggressive pathing. You know, he spent more time looking for ganks, but he got his mid leader that gold advantage. So it kind of just comes down to where do you prioritize that going? And with the kill on Froggen as well, I think that that can set Victor off to the races because this is a champion that can hard carry games.
Definitely agree. We'll see if Froggen can do it here. Right now, Moon's going to be pushed away, trying to play for some of the ward control. Still does hold that level lead over Acadian in the individual matchup. Otherwise, his game fairly close. One level lead for Froggen, one level lead for Elimination. We wait around in the mid game. Acadian and Gate are going to combo up for the Cloud Drake. Should be pretty easy to grab this for themselves. Froggen also with priority on mid, it seems, able to walk down and even keep able to do it. So, both of those southern lanes able to come over, and out of combat boost speed, never a bad thing here for Echo Fox. They're going to continue to stack what they can for this game. Ball's going to look for a trade and a Looper, but I feel like he's never going to be at a point where he wins this matchup, and that's fine. Camille's not going to be winning the 1v1. She is there to be the teamfight utility for that ultimate, and we'll just kind of wait to see if that comes through.
And I think that you still can eventually win the 1v1, potentially later on, you know, once you've completed things like a Triforce. But if you look at Ball's inventory, it's not exactly
close.
The most impressive components that he has stacked up for himself here.
Yep.
You know, once you have the Sheen, once you have the Triforce for the true damage with that Triforce proc, you can actually become pretty strong.
Bit of damage there on a Looper, but you're right, it's going to be a long way to go. Balls right now, his inventory is basically just his legs, a couple of swords. And right now, they're not very sharp.
Meanwhile, got Looper's one for each foot.
Yeah, exactly, right? That's going to work out for him. Looper, meanwhile, a hammer and two swords to go with his bat lift, and he'll be all right. Moon's still just playing the farm game, and it is generally a fairly slow early game as Acadian hasn't found too many of those openings, but now we have the roams coming in. Gate heading to the top side, the Ash played by Keith coming as well. Four people top side. Quick control ward comes down and they reveal their intentions, and it's going to be FlyQuest to get it first anyway. They're just pushing faster, and that's going to happen with Caitlyn plus the Zyra. First turret gold going to go through solo to Altec. 650 gold on him. The best play that Echo Fox had was trying to answer that back. They will trade the turret. It would just be down that 300 individual gold, and keep in mind the push is still faster from FlyQuest.
And I think that it's not only about the fact that they got the first turret, but they actually funnel the gold into a better person. I think getting all that bonus gold on one player is more effective. getting that 650 gold on Caitlyn. This is what they've got for themselves with this winning 2v2. And if both teams continue, this is just even better for FlyQuest because they have more minions left. They're faster on the push. This is not a push that Echo Fox can continue. They can actually get some damage down on this inhibitor turret.
I think they're going to go for that right now. Of course, again, as you mentioned, the minion wave is bigger and they've been a little bit faster on the play, so they're able to push this in first. They deny the wave under turret. Of course, that was already done by FlyQuest. Looks like these are both going to be kind of bouncing back as they stand. A little basically equal. And Echo Fox, actually, in the wake of all the top lane push, are going to get themselves this early Rift Herald. That's actually going to help Looper quite a bit. You can see individually, he's already up 700 gold over balls, and it's going to be even worse for the FlyQuest top laner with his Rift Herald off. Looper has had mediocre performances this year. He's had some great ones and some kind of head scratches, but this could be a game where he and Froggen kind of together can win this game.
Yeah, definitely. And I think the Rift Herald is pretty undervalued at times. It's not that the buff isn't powerful, it's that, oh god.
Oh, he didn't get any plants down for the initial spawns. Lemon just never hits W the entire time, gets the kill anyway. The ignite is on despite the flash. Looper, well, head scratch moment, that's one right there. Solo kill, the one and only FlyQuest's support.
I think he was caught shopping there. Just not really paying attention to his character. Lemon just simply walks up and is able to take him out. A little bit of an embarrassing moment is, that's probably gonna cost him the top lane turret.
It's going to be a lot of damage, you're right. Looper wishes he was alive to TP in to defend this one turret. Very low on health, damage on the gate.
Frog
and here comes
up,
the arrow.
Though.
It's on the balls. Acadian is there. They don't want to all in the Camille, tanky enough as she is. And the Roam's going to keep the turret alive, but 80% of that turret health is gone.
And they're just going to continue pushing because Hai is already pushing in the mid lane, so someone has to answer that. Otherwise, they're giving up even more. And they've spotted Froggen moving back towards mid lane. They know they can continue this push up on top side. So nice little play there from FlyQuest.
Here comes the resume, and with arrow down, not much of a chance. The threat of plants keeping off the turret, and there we go. 3-2 in turrets. FlyQuest do continue to use his Caitlyn as a battering ram. You expect them to win the matchup based on champions, based on player skill. And FlyQuest right now have basically gotten first turret gold because of it, and then unanswered top lane outer turret because of it, using that Caitlyn advantage, using alt tech. The one lane that's actually winning, by the way. The only lane that's winning. Whereas Echo Fox have Looper who's ahead and Froggen who's ahead, and yet it's FlyQuest with their one ahead member actually using that to get advantages.
Yeah, it's a very significant advantage, and any time you can take Caitlyn and move her around the map, have her pushing turrets, have her not really fighting players, but kind of just fighting turrets in the early stages, and get her to that 2-3 item stage very quickly, you're going to be super, super happy, because I think that Caitlyn on two items is such a powerful team fighter, and at three items, you really can take over a game.
Definitely, she can pull out a lot. I think she scales quite well, and in my mind, actually, my opinion of sort of Caitlyn's pushing power is like this is kind of her best situation where you've got a lot of raw AD and you've not kind of gotten a crit just yet because you sort of transitioned from like an early game poke spellcaster into more of an auto attacker, and it's like at 50 crit you finally get good, but for the next 5 minutes it feels awkward to me as a Caitlyn player, and right, we'll see what else can happen. Of course, as Keith kind of pushes forward, Ruin King Dunn means a power spike's in for him.
One of the really nice things about Caitlyn that I think makes her strong in the late game stages is not necessarily like that she has the highest DPS potential compared to like a Sivir or things like that, but it's that you can more safely attack because you have your 90 caliber net, you have your trap line, and you have such long range. So your effective DPS is often much higher simply because it's safer to actually go up and do those attacks.
Completely agree. Expected value, basically, of a Caitlyn is going to be pretty high because there's not a lot of risk in your attacks. We have more moves coming on, though. We got to point out the fact that Froggen has roamed down to the mid lane and pressed for that outer turret. Froggen being used, again, we talk about players with leads. Froggen is one of them. Keith is not. So Froggen's the battering ram. Keith holds the wave. He's actually shot an arrow out. Looks for Altec, not going to find it, but there was a chance, of course, for Looper to follow up on that damage. But meanwhile, it's the race against the fact that Altec is pushing up at the top side. Top lane tier 2 going to be killed off, and this is a 1-for-1. Top tier 2 for bot lane outer, and Altec's faster on the play.
It feels like a bit of a bizarre handshake to me from Echo Fox, because I think that having the Camille just kind of scaling and pre-farming and having the Caitlyn scaling and pre-farming is more advantageous than getting the same for the Renekton and the Ashe. So to me, it's to make this exchange where you're just agreeing to trade turrets all the time is more advantageous for the FlyQuest team.
The one caveat I will say to that, and I agree with you in general, turret for turret and the farm for farm the way it is. Well, and ball's running away. Froggen does have flash, goes for the Q. He's quick, he's looking for it, he's not an. Oh, he does get it, actually. The laser comes through, nicely done by Froggen. Gets his beat and gets out of that one. But of course, mid lane outer has been killed, and FlyQuest still pushing much faster.
I mean, this is 5 turrets in 17 minutes. FlyQuest is just taking almost all these turrets essentially unopposed. It feels like Egobox has not been able to mount much of a defense. They do get the kill on the bot side, which will get them a little bit of pressure down there and perhaps make FlyQuest back off. But we're not even 20 minutes into the game. There's only one outer turret still standing for Egobox.
Yeah, and you can see the 4v4 for FlyQuest was better. Their weakest member versus the strongest of Egobox. And yeah, it's a good kill for Froggen.
Yeah, Froggen very strong at this point. Balls has no magic resist. Able to commit the flash, does take him down. So pretty aggressive, well played there by Froggen.
Mm-hmm. But you're right, I think the map is kind of opening up for FlyQuest. You can see their gold lead right now, 1300. But I do want to give one caveat, which is that Egobox have taken the non-gold neutral objectives. Looper on your screen has referral buff, double Cloud Drake, Internet loves to malign. I think it's still very strong. Egobox gonna have some strength with his move speed. And there's these non-gold advantages that Egobox can use. And to be fair, this close in gold for being up three non-gold neutrals, I feel like, on a general level, I feel like I would rather have Egobox. If you ignore team comps, like I'd rather have two Drakes and Rift Herald than 1,500 gold.
And I would certainly agree with you if I was ignoring team comps, but Lemon, make it pick up, nice shot.
Ooh, wow, the burst is there. Moon doesn't need the ulti, but the chase is on. Looper gets the stun, gets the kill, picks up a one for one, but he's in dangerous territory, gets kicked off and trades his life, and there's the ulti in on Froggen. No way out of the hexagon here for this one, but he's got the shields, he's got the damage, and Balls gonna give up his life for that one. Froggen finding his third kill of the game, 100% KP, and Egobox able to make this fight a 2-for-2.
And nicely played on the tail end there from Egobox. I don't think Balls really should have been chasing that far in. His team was not in position to actually support him.
Yeah.
They did get a very quick pick on the Gate, but Moon committed his ultimate when Gate was already dead, and then High was already kind of low and pushed back. They did not have actually the extra resources to push forward for that kill.
Yeah, I agree. It's two deaths in a row now. Well, not in a row, but two deaths that Balls has had by saying, I'm going to go in on Frog, and ooh, he has more damage than I expect, because he's building armor for the matchup he's got, gets practically true damaged on by Frog, and it gets pushed around, and it's twice he's misjudged the damage up, but to be honest, and you can kind of see that Falls not on tanks, honestly not convinced. Part of the reason they've been having this late split drop. We can watch this fight again.
Yeah, and the initial pick, I think, is great from FlyQuest. It's the initiation coming out from Egobox, but then the shockwave into the body slam. The ultimate being committed there is a little bit extra. It's understandable, though, that Moon wasn't sure he was going to go down. And I think that Looper, that's not a dive you really want to make, because although he does trade a kill, you're trading the support for the solo laner. And here is where I think the initiation is fine from Balls, but his team is not actually in position to back him up. Yeah. So you can't go for that if your team is not there to follow up. I mean, if all four of the members still alive are right in position, I think you win that fight, but
sure,
they were not.
Yeah, I agree with you. And one thing I want to point out, though, is props to Froggen. Or shout out to Froggen, as the week was, as last week's phrase was. He actually didn't burn ulti onto Balls. He put it onto High and said, High, you
smart.
Can't follow up. We have enough damage to kill off the diver. I'm going to zone out the back line. That is a clarity of execution that many players don't have, and I wanted to make sure I gave Froggen props for. Part of the reason he even lived was zoning out the back line by himself and letting the team follow up on the front line.
Completely, and that's one of the things that Victor can do, which is really powerful. Even without the ultimate, your laser is extremely threatening, and the amount of burst that he's going to have, even single target now, with the Sheen building towards the Lich Bane, is going to be massive. At this point, when you complete the Lich Bane, a 3-0 Victor, if you ever get up onto this Caitlyn, yes, it is a powerful teamfighter, but you still have one time, you will die very quick with one round of spells, I think.
Absolutely. We'll see what happens here in this one. The game only 1,000 apart, but the mid lane siege is in. Altec traps off the left side flank. Here comes the damage from the turret. About 100 core hit. As they try to wear it down, Gate knows he can't come through this one easily, unless he wants to eat a cupcake, which, to be fair, is based on his skin, maybe he wants to. And just the disengage as the reinforcements have come. The siege will be delayed for now. Gate gets a nice blue, and actually, I believe he took it?
Yeah, he meant to give that over to Froggen, did end up taking that over.
Accidental steal, unlucky there.
See?
Moon realizes his jungle's gone. Does have a Gromp to kill, but it's complete fog of war. He can't really go for that.
And Froggen back to playing around the mid lane bush. This is one of, I think, Froggen's trademark moves. When he's on a Nivy, he's always going for these sorts of picks. And it feels like almost every game, Froggen is able to get control of these side lane bushes and create a pick at some point in the game. I really do think he is very intelligent when playing around.
Let's see what they can grab for themselves. Because Froggen is the lead right now. And he's the one to watch for if Egobox is going to win, which, if you look at the lineup on paper, you think that's pretty likely to be about him. And this game so far, it has been. We'll see if they can keep pushing in with this. Arrow's gonna land onto High. That could be a really good pick. The burst damage is there, and there's the kill picked off. Akajian gets his first kill of the game. And nicely done. Keith, they put him on the ash this time around. At least it's working for that regard. He's got 3 assists. Those arrows, at least 2 of them have resulted directly in kills for his team.
Yeah, great arrow. And with this mid lane turret this low, I definitely think FlyQuest needs to back off. We have Looper in position to look for a flank, and they stay around to actually fight it. And they may just try to set up a dive because Balls is not here. Yeah, here they go.
Then here comes Looper. Here comes the dive. They find Moon. They find Lumination. Both of cast doesn't buy a lot of time. The first kill comes through. Looper onto the turret. Makes sure they can go for the next. But Keith pulls aggro, and they've got to block the snipe, and they do so. The 1-0, though, they might get the comeback onto Looper, forcing the flash away. He stays alive.
And Balls is pushing topside at the same time. He's trying to shove this in. We'll see if he can get anything more. He's going for the inhibitor turret.
Well, he's got Triforce, and that Q's going to be a lot of damage. So it will be... Yeah, a lot of health off right now. Ash has recalled, but you can see the damage up, but Ball's able to put this flip push game, and this has worked for him, actually. Turret destruction, name of the game. Able to answer an inhibitor turret for that kill. I don't think he's long for the world anymore. Doesn't have a way out, not a chance anymore, but it is 3 straight Drakes. Akkadian gets his third, and all said and done, 3 kills and a Drake for a turret. I still side with Echo Fox.
Yeah, certainly do. And I think that was very well played by them, getting the initial pick and then forcing the play around there. And FlyQuest, I think, did not really play safe enough, knowing that their top laner still didn't have his TP for a little bit of time and not seeing the Renekton on the map. You have to kind of expect that they are going to look for one of those plays, even with a pretty solid disengage from Moon. Mm-hmm. The 5-3 advantage is just way too much.
Yeah, totally agree. And of course, good by Echo Fox to pull the trigger. It's a team that we have maligned for bad and overly safe late game shot calling, and at least realizing that a 5v3 turret dive is a good call, it does work for them, and they get the one extra kill for this one.
The question to me is going to be, can you actually make that inhibitor turret pay off by getting Balls into a position where he's winning the one-on-one and either draws pressure or takes that inhibitor turret? And because he has had a pretty bad start to the game, you know, 0-4, down 50-plus CS, he's not probably at that stage just yet, but if he can get there and 1v1 Looper, that gives them a win condition for sure.
Speaking of win conditions, though, the arrow comes in again. And this one just silly by Moon, though. Kind of wavering by himself with nothing to play for. Just eats an arrow to the face, goes down. And
they are going to look towards Baron. I think they could just start it up and try to bait FlyQuest in. I don't know if a full commit to this will make sense, but we'll see if the play's going to come through. Ball's TPing in.
TPing in means the play is in. 6,000 health on Baron. Nash elimination puts some plants in. They look for Frog and takes a bit of damage. Shockwave not going to come through just yet, but high. Can still pull the trigger. Balls wants in. Can't find the stun, though. Gravity Well means the kill's going to come through. They're dominating now. Froggen is 3,000 health as Yoda joins the cast. There's the kill. Nice flash to get away from the shockwave. 1,000 left on the Baron. No chance to steal it away. Moon was already
down
dead.
Froggen.
And that's going to be 3 kills already in this fight. And it's going to be a complete slaughter. Echo Fox, 3,000 gold with a Baron buff.
They get the pick onto Moon, and I think Froggen played that team fight so well. Zoning high out once again at the beginning of the fight. So when Balls goes in, there's no support for him. The ball cannot be thrown onto him. And they're going to be able to get a lot off of this. With the Baron buff, a couple members still down. We'll see how much gold they can rack up.
It might be a lot. Baron power plays tend to be in the tune of 3,000 to 4,000 gold, I think, is the general average. And there's certainly some turrets still to kill. Like a Fox have only grabbed 4, meaning mid and bot tier 2, the likely ones that they can grab.
And I think you really just have to focus on Froggen in this fight. He knows where the majority of the threat is going to come from. Throwing down the ult, zoning it high, so you can see Balls going in, but he does not have the support of his team. You cannot go forward like this without high right there to snap that ball onto you and look for the follow-up. So overcommitment again, that's I would say the third straight time really that he has had that happen. And then Froggen flashing forward, finishes off the kill onto high. They secure the Baron. Very nicely done from him. 702, having a super impressive game on the next week.
280 CS as well in 26-minute game. Froggen is, at least in this one, back on form, the one that his fans know him to have. And that Deathfire Touch, Victor putting out plenty of damage over the course of a fight. Shockwave only going to get minions. I think still the right choice by high, but it's not going to matter enough because there's still plenty alive. And there's turret number 1 from the Baron buff. 2 minutes left to go as they're going to look for mid lane tier 2.
I think thinning out that wave is a reasonable choice, but they already have the wave prepped in mid lane. And with this Lich Bane, Froggen takes down the turret so ridiculously fast, so they will be able to press this, already extending the gold lead quite a bit.
Yeah, Baron buff being picked up at 1,500. The kill's already a couple hundred more on top of that, and 2 turrets adding another 1,000 and change to the pools right now. Echo Fox, look at their lead, almost 6,000.
And FlyQuest have to be very careful here because they have this window of opportunity where Shockwave is down, and if Echo Fox sees an opportunity, they can look for an aggressive play because of that, and they may go right for the turret. We'll see.
They try, knockback, almost puts Looper into the turret. It was pretty close, but the wall saves his life. Scumbag FlyQuest base, actually. Keeps it afloat. Going to stop the push for now, but still a minute 15 on Baron buff. Gives plenty of time for Echo Fox to reset and go for one last wave. Is Frog going to maybe recall and buy items as well?
There have been a couple of near misses with those Drag Assaults. You know, if we think back to the early fight around First Blood, where it's just a little bit mispositioned for Moon, and again here, that is something if you're not playing Gragas all the time, it can be tough to hit those angles and really know exactly where you have to place it at all times.
Especially when your opponents move, that can sometimes be impossible. The one in the jungle, I think, was definitely on Moon's fault, like the level 2, like, or level 6, obviously, invade, where he had the stun and kind of misplaced it. But yeah, that one is always hard when Rex is moving around.
It certainly is.
Either way, we are back in for the 40 seconds remaining Baron buff push as Echo Fox look at now inhibitor turrets themselves. Keep in mind FlyQuest already taking on the top lane one, so if they ever do find themselves a fight win, they've got an easy inroad to the base. Echo Fox have to work a little bit harder as Acadian pushes in the top lane wave. The rest of the team waits in the jungle, and they have not yet found a kill.
It has been an extremely passive game overall. Both teams really prioritizing those objectives. And I think, you know, to your early point, the fact that you highlighted the priority around dragons for Echo Fox, that actually does matter quite a bit more as you're getting to later stages of the game when you're coming up on Elder, especially if they can grab this next potion. Then you have such a massive threat with the Elder from that true damage burn that you've stacked up throughout the game.
Absolutely. We'll see what comes in. Balls wants the dive, gets kicked right back out on a frog, and what an explosive cast! Donates the gold lead away, and now it's Lufra's turn to run away, scared and hiding as the stun comes in. The knockup flashes the wall to buy a bit of time, and his Q's gonna heal him up in a second. The chase is coming through. Acadian still pushing up at the top side of the map, being maybe attacked by Altec, who's, yeah, probably a bit afraid of the assassin while being one level down, and Acadian gonna knock down this turret. So Echo Fox trade Froggy's life away for a turret kill. An elimination and gate in a duel, but here comes Acadian, gonna land the slow, gonna land the flash, get away. Gate gonna be attacked, here comes the slow, the volley not gonna be enough, and the Gromp might even go for taking a bite out of the Lulu. That's gonna be kill, picked up, Ball's finally on the scoreboard here, and this one, Hive wants to chase Keith. Shockwave already down, of course, that was dodged away. Keith flashes the new believe. And now Acadian on the wrong side of the fight once again, eats a cupcake for his troubles. Kill comes through, and turns out that there's gonna be three kills in a row picked up for FlyQuest at cost of only one turret.
A lot of kills given over there, and the rest timer for Acadian is actually quite long. We'll see if FlyQuest can get out on the map, control some vision, really get anything off of this, because as of now, their waves are not in a position to do it, and it's actually Echo Fox starting up the dragon.
And Lucha's gonna try for this one. Right now, it's been a game of FlyQuest separately thinking about those objectives. Theoretically, that team could rush the Drake and get it 100% of the time, but they are very slow in trying. They would rather play for minion waves, lick up some of the gold they had lost, and try to fill their coffers once more. It looks like there was enough threat based on being around the mid lane. Actually, turns out FlyQuest played it well and properly judged how much damage Echo Fox had. And right, they get the first Drake of the game. They mirror the ocean Drakes that were picked up.
Looper just doesn't really do that much damage at this stage in the game. Maybe if he's on a Titanic Hydra and some more aggressive items, he could look for that. But here's the play again from Moon. Beautifully executed. He knows Froggen has that lead. Body slam flash, ultimate in. No greedy auto attack in between. Very, very nice. And when you can pick off that super strong member, the rest of the team has to go into full retreat.
Really nicely done by him. That flank was maybe game saving. It's still a gold deficit. It's 5,000 down still. A lot of room to go for FlyQuest, but that individual play means a lot. They got two more kills in the end of it. They even got the first Drake, so we'll see the comeback can happen very late in this game. Flame Horizon in the top lane as Azale points it out with a pen. Looper very far ahead in his matchup.
Yeah, Looper is so strong. And you know, I talked about earlier the fact that Balls, hey, maybe in the late game he can start to outscale as you get those additional items because you have the true damage and you're building a little bit more for that one-on-one. But it just does not seem like that's ever going to get to that point in this game because Looper is so massively ahead in the farm and
almost
a couple 3, levels up.
3,000 gold, two levels. You don't win a 1v1 if that's the case. And Looper actually doesn't go for the play. Kind of figured he might be attacked by other people.
Yeah.
Turns out no one was around, though.
Hadn't spotted Gragas, hadn't really seen a number of the members of FlyQuest, so I think you have to give the respect that someone else could be there and makes a smart play.
It makes the risk-averse play. This is a game where Echo Fox are up 5,000 gold. You don't need to take the 1v1 risk. You can just play for the team fights, play for the Baron attempts. And last time we saw, Echo Fox have been able to play around Fog of War, land an arrow on a crucial member, and then properly play a Baron 5v4. Honestly, Echo Fox, this is a game where they're actually winning based on good shot calling. And it's a game where FlyQuest actually managed to stay alive in lanes and are getting out called and out macroed by Echo Fox.
You know, one thing to kind of put something for FlyQuest is basically the fact that it's almost all the gold is on Froggen, and you have playmaking ability. If you can pick Froggen off in a fight, someone like Altec can very easily take over a fight after that. I mean, Altec is almost at that 80% crit stage, already has his Lord Dominix, he has the CC of the QSS, so he's really getting to a very strong point. And if Froggen is not there to zone him out and kind of keep him afraid, he certainly has the potential to take over a fight.
Totally agree. Altec is going to be scary. 70% crit already in, and as you mentioned, Lord Dominix in as well. Pretty close to Locket elimination, double Null Magic Mantle. He has roughly the ages combined, and Locket's not far after that one. That will also help quite a bit against the Victor piloted by Froggen. But of course, Locket.
Have arrow. They might look for Lemon.
You can see Lemon trying to maybe bait out Thaze. He's going to land it onto Moon, who's tanky enough, and looks like they make the re-engage. The knockup is going to be there. A big push in. They're going to find Keith, who overextends for the chase, and maybe throws with the team, but a trade kill onto Moon's going to come through, courtesy of Looper and Froggen, but now it's two carries left only on the Equifox side. Disengage for now, 4v4. Watch out for the ball, though. High looking for the play. We can see Froggen steering clear, once again putting it in the front of the team. I can't find a good shotgun just yet. 4v4 waiting for Moon to respawn.
FlyQuest can push up mid though, and that's what they're gonna do. So Equifox has kind of put themselves in between a rock and a hard place. They either have to start the Baron or just sacrifice it completely now. I think their only option is to start the Baron, as Altec is already on the inhibitor.
But a 3v4 Baron is a pretty easy stop, actually. FlyQuest playing this situation as well as they could have with the limited vision they had. And Equifox went for risky play. It backfired. They're gonna lose out on this.
They just need to stop the bases now. They actually do stop the bases, and they're gonna get some kills.
And it's gonna be Gate going down. Froggen as well, stuck inside the ultimatum. And one more is gonna be picked up. Yeah, they got the trade in a high, but it's still advantage. FlyQuest balls finally getting a dive that's working out for him. In the duel against Acadian, he's running out of health pretty rapidly. Acadian, though, has to be careful. Elimination.
Oh, nice.
The snipe's gonna come
play
through. Nicely done. The double kill in for Balls. And the game almost back to tied.
And Moon is back up. There's three members down for Equifox. They can take this Baron now. Balls may TP back in for it. There's also two exposed inhibitors.
Yeah.
I think they're gonna start it up.
Here comes the TP in. It's gonna be the four-man attempt, and this is gonna be, I think, a pretty secure Baron. FlyQuest
should be very easy.
With this pickup, should tie up the gold and have a Baron play of their own to try to close the game out with, maybe.
And look at the minion waves already for them. They may want to base and spend up this gold, so they will lose the advantage of those prepped minion waves, but still going to be at a very, very strong point. And I think this is so well done from High.
They're
basing
on
that ward. He just had to stop them from basing, and he was able to accomplish that, but he's able to pull off even more. And Balls being pretty effective in the later stages of the game, showcasing that Camille mobility, and it is finally kind of getting involved in a good way for FlyQuest.
Totally agree. And then just the re-engage right there. It's like, okay, I'm in range. I'll tech, let go for the snipe. All in the stun, and they got that one kill through. 9-kill Victor. Unfortunately, if you eat a shockwave to start a fight or you eat an explosive catch to start a fight, you don't get to do much. And that's what's been happening right now. Froggen needing to stay alive.
And that's part of the problem when it's feeling a bit like a one-threat team. You know, Keith has not been able to be super effective in the actual fights. He's landed some great arrows, but he has not been a massive team fight threat. And I don't really see Acadian being able to get in there very safely and take out the back line. So, so much of it is on Froggen, and FlyQuest is kind of using that against them. Mm-hmm. They have Gragas who can lock him down. They have Camille who can lock him down. They're kind of really focusing on him.
Here we go, the push in on towards Moon. Arrow lands in the tank, but Looper actually running out of health pretty rapidly. Acadian cannot find the flank just yet. Looper healed up. Guardian Angel popped. They're going to keep chasing on the Moon. Balls still split pushing. This is a 5v4 team fight right now. They once again find Looper. He's tanky enough to get away with it, though. And now Acadian going to have to jump away. Comes close to dying, to be honest. And that's bottom inhibitor dead already. The ball split push has been working out.
Yeah, and then just push in now. I think this is an easy three inhibitors. They can move around, take them all. There's no GA on Looper. Their ultimate is down. Their flash is down. No ultimate on Froggen. I don't know how they can actually fight back against this. It's going to be tough.
Seems unlikely. Equifox going to lose their third inhibitor in about a 5-second window right now. So the minion's going to start flooding in soon. There's a minute and 40 seconds left on Baron buff. It's easy reset into a push with a million super minions.
Yeah, I think that FlyQuest may want to go set up around the Elder because that seems like kind of last hope here for Equifox, but we'll see if they're going to move for that or just try to go for the end of the game because Equifox is surely going to try to rush this down.
They're going to rush Drake, and there's not a TP up for Balls right now, and two of them have already recoded. The bot lane's not here, so a potential 5v4, if Equifox can dwindle it, it's very unlikely, but this is a moment that has to work well. Ball's pushing the base right now, by the way. He's got minions coming in. Balls needs to catch the wave, though. He forgot where the minion wave was. High pushes it in. And so Balls on the minimap is looking for the game-ending play in the mid lane. Equifox still stuck inside their base. They've got to realize they will instantly lose the game if they get stuck outside the base like this. Balls is pushing onto the Nexus. Equifox trying to make this happen 5v4. Balls still trying to close the game out with this one. The turrets about to be under fire. So here comes the play that could just end the game outright. No one is recalling it for Echo Fox. They've got to realize this. It's actually Froggen who comes back, so he can keep the base alive. That will happen, but now Balls is on the flank to win a 5v4 and find an engage.
Oh, he's actually looking for the 1-on-1 against Froggen. We'll see if he can pull it off.
And it's going to be pretty difficult. Gets stunned back in. Of course, he's got Guardian Angel, but he's keeping Froggen out of the fight, which means something, of course. And it's not even close between those two, but the 4v4 still works for FlyQuest. Balls, maybe bites up more than he can chew. Lich Bane's going to be a lot of damage, and Froggen going to flash ball. Going to get the solo kill, and now the re-engage. This could have been an actually huge misplay for Balls. It turns out Froggen was there, and Balls gives up the ghost.
All Balls had to do was just move for the collapse. He was way faster to the Dragon Pit. They could have had a 5v4. Instead, he tries to force the 1v1 outplay, doesn't get it. And now, FlyQuest in
Body Slam Flash, can't get the Explosive Casket, was down right now. It's going to be a bit of Redemption heal as Echo Fox look for the play. The base is still dying, though, of course. Keep in mind, Frog has to keep that alive against the inhibs, and two kills have been picked up already. FlyQuest able to navigate through this 4v4, sorry, only one kill so far. The base is what's been dying. Keith forced to flash heal away. One more hit will kill him off. All day with the red buff, gets the double kill for himself. And here comes the push to close the game out. Froggen actually can't handle the triple inhibitor. This game will end no matter how that team fight goes. At this point, Froggen trying to kite them back in, but FlyQuest surely gonna close one out. It's a 4v3. They've got triple inhibitor down as well. And they've got the structures in their sights. The bot lane of Echo Fox is dead. Explosive cast doesn't mean much. Shockwave buys some time. It's just the Nexus in their eyes at this point, and the damage should be there. They're trying to fight FlyQuest back, but the minions are there, and Balls to the Nexus. It's going to be ending right now. It's gone. Balls got the TP, got the game-winning call, and the Nexus is dead. Game one, a rowdy one, but a win for FlyQuest.
Certainly a bit of a messy one, but the early investment in Altec really paid off this game. Altec was massive throughout. Deathless, up nearly 100 CS. He had a very strong game, and they never were really able to get to him in the late game stages. He was a consistent damage threat, positioned very well, and it just felt like, although Froggen was so strong, he was only one man, and there wasn't really the backup in the team fights.
Yeah, and you're right, absolutely. As far as backup in team fights are concerned, I have the post-game stats right here. Damage comparison, it's outlandish. There's 30,000 damage came out this game from Froggen, and it was 11K. From both Keith and the Kha'Zix of Akkadian. So it was not even close. He was roughly half his team's damage overall.
Yeah, I mean, when you're doing as much damage as your jungler, your top laner, and your AD combined,
more than, I'm pretty sure.
It's very difficult to actually win those team fights because they just over-index on stopping you. And as long as you stop Froggen, you win the fight, right?
Yeah.
Even if he kills off Balls, even if he kills off the Gragas, the Caitlyn being untouched, it's so easy for her to succeed in a fight like that.
Absolutely the case. And it's kind of worth pointing out, though, that really none of these fights were won by FlyQuest in like a heads-up, five-on-five, let's clash. All the team fights they won were a sweet flank, a nice shockwave, something atypical, unusual, something that was, it required some level of outplay. One of them was a picture-perfect moon flank where he came around where there were no
wards. That was beautiful.
The body slam flash explosive cask was like necessary to have a chance in that game. The second time around that they won a fight, they were just recalling on a ward and high stuck a shockwave in. But those mistakes don't happen, or those outplays don't happen. This game looked like it was going to be Echo Fox's based on how it was going. But hey, a win is a win. Of course, congratulations. FlyQuest did make it happen. Sloppy as it was, they did get the wins. Let's throw it down to our analysts and see what they make of that one.
Thank you very much, Freak. I have to agree with what he said there right at the end.
Day of comebacks.
Yes, exactly. It's the day of comebacks, and Echo Fox in this situation had control of the game, had every opportunity to win, and we'll get to some of the mistakes that ultimately resulted in the loss here for them. Before we get to that, though, let's take a look at Champ Select just so we kind of have a picture of what both teams are equipped with. The first thing I notice is the Camille in the top lane. And although they do get the win this time around, we have to take note of Ball's performance on this champion across all of the games that he's played this split. Has never looked too great on it.
Yeah, as soon as you see it locked in, you get a little bit worried because FlyQuest haven't done that well with Balls on a split pusher.
Right.
And you can see a lot of his tendencies are still in the tank mindset where he's just jumping in, charging ahead. And this time, it did cost him in the early game in the skirmish in the jungle. He died there. It cost him a couple times in team fights where he jumped the gun and went in a little bit far, and he's a squishier Camille.
You can see here, no one goes thirsty at the North American LCS. Anyway, sorry to derail that entire conversation, Kobe. Back to Balls on Camille.
and the rest of the team as well. There were a decent amount of individual mistakes, but what really brought it together for FlyQuest was, again, a focused game plan.
Mm-hmm.
And we do often, you know, contribute this to shot calling, to being like, okay, we'll get past these individual mistakes, back to the mission. You know, we need to worry about these towers. We're shoving down the towers. We need to worry about pushing up the minion waves.
Right.
These sorts of steps that they're able to return to after making individual mistakes is what gave them this comeback.
Right, absolutely. So let's jump into the replays itself, the picks that give FlyQuest control of this game, popping up here behind us.
All right, so this is going to be the big comeback. FlyQuest, Moon gets a good ultimate off of the snare from Lemonation here to be able to get Keith, and then they get the counter kill on Moon, so it's a 1v1 kill. You know, Echo Fox, the game is not over right here, but there's a big mistake. You can see them meandering around. Look at the minion waves, and attention to detail here. Echo Fox seemed to be thinking maybe a couple seconds in advance and like, where's the nearest threat? We have to deal with this right now.
Exactly.
The Baron is up. Enemy team is right here. And so they move back into the river here. However, you're giving away control of this mid lane where minions have already taken the turret, and that's a much easier threat. You're not going to start a 4v4 Baron and get a lot out of that at this point.
Right.
Even though the Ashe is dead, you know, there are ways for both teams to check vision here, and you're not going to force something. Minions, super easy to go for, and FlyQuest right up the middle.
Yeah, and we'll roll this out. You can see how the play unfolds. Basically, FlyQuest, shot caller at the wheel here, decides, okay, great, even though we don't have our jungler, we'll send one person to go for turret, while the members that still have ultimate in the Orianna can defend easily in a 3v4 scenario.
Exactly. Orianna is so good at checking inside there. You know, Zyra can throw out a lot of harassment at range as well. And FlyQuest make a very easy and calculated call, thinking a couple of steps ahead of pushing up the middle, you know, stopping the backs very easily. And Echo Fox are like, meanwhile, like, oh, we can't do Baron. Oh, no, they got us with a Scrying Orb. Well, I guess they all recall in sporadic areas. And it went from, you know, poor setup to worse and worse and worse as they're trying to freak out and deal with the situation at hand. Planning goes a very long way.
Right, and it kind of mirrors Series 1 of the evening, right, where Dignitas had control of the game. They build good leads, but then you start to see, you know, them start to fall apart in that mid-game where they have to make, you know, decisions that will have effect for the next 3 to 4 minutes in the game. Again, when you're laning, you make a poor decision. Okay, in that moment, you might have a disadvantage, but once you get past that 15, 20, 25-minute mark, any poor decision results in 5 minutes of negativity.
And you get a little scared, too. Even though FlyQuest had, like, 3 inhibitors there or something, and Balls makes the trying 1v1 frog it up there.
Oh, Kobe, that hurt me.
And you're like, then they still bring it back, so.
Exactly, yeah. And that's the thing. It's like, we cannot ignore the individual mistakes from FlyQuest, especially when we look at them as compared to the better teams in the league, right? The ones that they had been dropping games to here in the second half of the split. If you're looking towards playoff, I definitely wouldn't say that I'd be happy with this win from FlyQuest, because we need to eliminate those individual mistakes moving forward. But we got the W here in game one, and now it's time to look towards game two. One thing I will notice, player of the game this time around, going to Alltech on that Caitlyn. It was very clear that with being able to funnel some gold into him early, that he's able to put out quite a decent scoreline and crazy damage percentage there for the team.
Definitely. Caitlyn's been a big champion for him. Very, very good performance on it once again for him. And like we said, to be able to continue to return to these pushing minion waves, pushing down these turrets, the team play aspect that got them through the individual mistakes, Caitlyn's a big part of that. You get the early turret advantage, and you kind of have this momentum to work with.
Absolutely. All right, well, FlyQuest pick up game one. We'll see if Echo Fox can even up the score against FlyQuest when we come back after the break. Don't go anywhere.
Okay. I'm shielding you.
Good. No, Victor. No, Victor.
Go.
Hello.
They're chunk. They're chunk. Johnny, you can go.
I need vision.
I'm looking to go.
Yep. Yep.
Chase. Chase.
I can TP in 30.
I can shield you. I spot you. I spot you.
Victor's still on base.
You can end. You can end.
They're losing the
flash. Flash forward. I have a speed in 3.
Speed.
2, 3, 2, 3, 2. I spot you.
Speed.
Keep going. We end this game, okay?
Yeah. Play together.